Hey folks, David Frost, my strategic forecast. You're here for another episode of Common Sense Market Analysis. Today is Thursday, January 3, 2019. We're looking at a daily chart of the SPY or SPDR, which is the proxy for the S&P 500. So just to state the obvious, the market got killed today, but what I'm going to show you in tonight's video are several examples how A, you need to pay attention to everything I say in these videos, and sometimes, and I know a lot of you do, watch them more than once. And the second thing is I'm going to show you from an intraday perspective where the trades existed, why, and that everything that's taught in my course and that everything that's discussed and taught in these videos each and every day still works no matter what the volatility is in the market, no matter whether we're headed down in a downtrend or we're headed higher in an uptrend. Either way, everything that I teach works over and over and over again, and I'm going to show you examples of that in this video. Before we get rolling, let me once again thank everybody for participating, making comments and posts underneath the video each and every night. I love the interaction. Please keep up the great work. In addition, please hit the thumbs up button on the video and share the video with anybody that you think can benefit from this information. So let's go back to a couple of the things that we've been discussing. We talked about the fact that this was likely a dead cat bounce in a downtrend. That's what it is. Today we had a down day. Personally, I would have liked to see the market get up to 255. That was in my trading plan. For example, if we got to 255, I was going to short the market with a lot of ammunition. We didn't do that. So even if we go higher now, I would have to reassess the 255. It should still probably be good. However, with the down day we had, could act as a launching pad if we were to turn around. Do I think that's going to happen? Not necessarily. I'm going to explain everything that I think is going to happen throughout the video. I just wanted to give you an indication of what I was looking at from a trading perspective. I think you all sensed that from last night's video that if the market got up to the 255 level, I was a willing participant on the short side. We also talked about the fact that we were getting into the time zone where the market would likely make a decision and we would be looking for signs and a signal of a trend change. We didn't get that. We just got a gap down this morning. The market doesn't always give you everything you want. You have to adapt to the current situation. The market gapped down, didn't give me the 255 I was hoping for, so be it. You put that aside and you look at the market for what it's giving you at that particular point in time and you take the trades that are offered up. We're going to discuss a couple of those trades that were offered up in a few moments. First, let's finish up on the daily chart and give you my thought process of where we go from here. The short answer is lower until and unless we can close back above 246. We have this red horizontal trend line at 245.95. Now, I want to show you the importance of that in a moment. We talked about it last night. I said that was a bogey. If we get below and start closing hourly below 245.95, that's not good for the bulls. Likely lower prices would be following. And that's what happened. But look what also happened at 245.95. And give or take anything on either side of that. But you can see what happened. So we were making this bullish pattern we discussed, and we were looking for, I was looking for, the market to finish this off to the upside, get up to 255, short the market, and go down from there. All right, so now the bullish pattern begins to fail. We gap down this morning, and we go right into the area of the 245.95. We actually got a little bit lower, but what happens if we went lower than that? Go back to last night's video. I discussed exactly what would happen and the next level of support. The next level of support was down around 244. There's a breakup candle low. The breakup candle low was 244.02. We discussed it last night. Look at the low of this candle here, 244.03. Anybody think that's an accident or a coincidence? I think not. Now, based on that, let's go take a look at the first trade of the day. Here's a 10-minute chart. The market comes down rather hard this morning, right into the breakup candle low by one penny, puts in a pseudo doji candle, has a retrace, and takes off to the upside. Everything I just told you is right out of the course. And that's not even everything. It's not even close to everything. We always talk about time being more important than price, and time works with price, and when they converge together, when time meets price, and they're both important at the same time, it's likely a recipe for another trade. Before I go over that one, let me circle back to the 244.02 area. When price comes into a breakdown candle high or a breakup candle low, we know a couple of things. A, we know it's not always going to work. Sometimes price is just going to trade through. That's a fact. The second thing we know is that the majority of the time, not all the time, but the majority of the time, the large majority of the time, on the first run to near or at that price level, the market is likely to have a reaction in the other direction, at least a small reaction. And so two other things are also important to realize when considering a trade. We want to be as close to risk as possible. So on the first trade, risk was right here. It was at 244.02. So if we took a trade here, for example, or here on a retracement, or at the number, we're very close to risk because we know that if price begins trading through and closing below this area, and even since it's a daily level, we know that we wouldn't even want to see 10-minute closes below that level, half-hour closes below that level, certainly an hourly close below that level. Even a 10-minute close below that level could certainly be a trick, trap, fool, and frustrate move. However, we always want to take the high road and not take on more risk than necessary. Sometimes your first loss is your best loss. Traders that have been around a long time fully understand that concept. If I have to take a small loss, I'll make it up on the next trade. If you follow the rules and only take the trades that the rules specify, you'll make it up on the next trade. What was the next trade anyway? Well, the next trade was somewhere up in this area. Why? Because it was near the opening range high, which is also a breakdown candle high or close to it. But more importantly, something else right out of the course was prevalent on the chart at that time. Once again, it was rather close to risk. If we were to close even a 10-minute candle above the opening range high, what's the opening range high? The first candle of the day, the high was 248.57. The high of this candle was 248.18. We didn't quite get there, but if we closed above that high, that would be bullish and the market would want to go fill the gap. It's just that simple. Will it work out like that every single time? No. Will it work out like that about three quarters of the time or more? Yes. Let's jump around a little bit. Back to the hourly chart. Where did we close the day? We closed the day above the breakup candle low, 244.02. That's at least something for the bulls to hang their hat on. But we know the more important number was 245.95. Speaking of which, look at something else right out of the course where there was another trade and it was a short trade toward the end of the day. Let's put that aside for a second. Any trader that's taken the course sees several things on this hourly chart that were A, picture perfect, and B, made the afternoon trade rather easy. Another one, right out of the course. Back to the daily chart, continuing on the theme of jumping around a little bit, let's discuss where we're going. So we have the phony jobs number tomorrow. That's likely to be a spark one way or the other. So whether we go up or down, let's discuss them both. Let's say the phony jobs number comes out and the market goes bananas in one direction or another for whatever the reason. It doesn't matter what the number is. It matters what the market does after the number is released. If we go down, I think we go visit at least 240. There's another area at 239. Why is that area important? I'll leave that to you to figure it out. It should become obvious. Now, under normal conditions, if we were to reach 240, 239 tomorrow, always depending on how we get there, let's assume for a second we get there rather quickly, just for the sake of conversation. It's likely that the market is going to find at minimum of some temporary intraday support at around 240, 239. It would be unlikely for that not to happen. Anything's possible, but I'll be going on the assumption that the market is likely to find some semblance of support in that area. Now, if we cut through it like a hot knife through butter, then I'm not sure that there's a lot of support in between 239 and 236 and a half, give or take. So that being the case, we'll give it its due. We'll put a trend line on the chart, and I've already moved the low down, 233.76. That was the low. So if we're going to revisit that low and break the low, then we would have to start looking at some of those other numbers that we discussed from a longer-term perspective. But we're not there yet. That's not what I'm saying is going to happen tomorrow. I'm just saying if the market goes down and it gets down as far as 240, 239, I think it's a setup similar to what happened today. What happens if the other side takes place? What happens if the spark is to the upside? Well, we'll have to take it one candle at a time if that happens, but if it does, I'm still going to be looking at 255 as a very, very important area. A couple of other things that we should note today. The volume. The volume was about average, and this is based on a 90-day average volume. So the average you see at the bottom, or today's volume at 140 million shares, 138.3, that's just a little bit above the 90-day average volume. And the reason I bring it up, I think it's important because I find it a little bit puzzling that on a down day like this, that we didn't have heavier volume. So that's definitely a puzzle piece. It's on the table. It's certainly in the back of my mind. Doesn't change anything I said already. It's just in the back of my mind. The other thing that I find a little bit interesting is the IWM. So the spider was down about 2.3%, give or take. The IWM was down less than the spiders. Now, it was still down 2% and it was still a heavy down day, $2.65. However, when you look at that and you say, why wasn't the IWM down more? Now, I'm not 100% sure of anything I'm about to say. This is pure speculation, but it's possible. I'm not saying probable yet. It's possible that these may be very, very early signs that at least initially a retest may develop into a higher low scenario. It's way too early for that kind of discussion. It's pure speculation. I'm just saying that when you start to see these things pop up, it's the reason I follow the IWM, volume trends, and some other things that are good indicators over time. Sometimes they're leading indicators, sometimes they're canaries in the coal mine. We've used the transports a number of times as canary in the coal mine, as do the IWM. So I'm just bringing to the forefront a couple of the things that I'm noticing, I'm keeping my eye on, but they're not meaningful yet in any way, shape, or form. They haven't even made it to be footnotes just yet. How about the VIX? What do we see over here? So the VIX was up about 10% today. Now that's a big day any way you look at it, but the point I want to bring out is, well, when the market was down, and when I say market, we'll pick one. So the S&P was down 62 points. The Dow was down 660. The transports were down 320. So everything was down pretty hard across the board, 9, 10%. I would have thought we would have a larger range in the VIX. Again, it's in the back of my mind. It's a puzzle piece. It kind of goes with the conversation of maybe setting up for a higher low. It's just another component to that story. And that's all it is right now, is just a story. On the flip side of that, here's a horror story. Look at the transports. They were down 3.5% today over 300 points. That's a big down day. The transports could be a canary in the coal mine on the other side of the equation. We'll see. They're certainly not on the same side as a higher low. The transports getting hammered like this are actually leading the market toward that prior low. Definitely a puzzle piece. It's on the table. We have two sides of the coin. We have, is the market going to find an semblance of a low and have some kind of a meaningful rally? And that's going to be at somewhere double bottom, a little higher, a little lower. That's one side of the equation. The other side of the equation is, what if that doesn't happen? What if there are much lower prices coming and we have to be prepared for that? And I am prepared for that. We've discussed those lower prices already. We're not going to discuss them tonight, but I'll bring them back out if we need them. The Q's got smoked today over 3%. A lot of that has to do with Apple. A lot of the market has to do with Apple. Certainly, Apple was a spark. I'm in the camp, it's not the reason, but I'll give it a spark for sure. When Apple came out last night and pre-warned about their sales, that certainly sent the market into a tizzy and was the spark for the decline. Just like the phony jobs number, it'll be another spark tomorrow. Speaking of Apple, by the way, I did get a lot of emails on Apple, so we have to go take a look at Apple, and we'll take a look at the chart, take a look at some numbers, see where we are. So this was the first number, was 141.88. I don't think we hit it today. The low was 142 even. I gave these numbers out to a few of the traders that had asked specifically last night about the numbers. Let me go to the weekly chart. We'll see. Another number is 135. And in between is 137, and somewhere in here should be support for Apple. Anything below 135, and you're looking at a buck and a quarter. Even as low as 120, 121, 122 in that neighborhood. 135 has to hold. Here's something. Let's just say for argument's sake that the market is trading down tomorrow. We're at that 240 level in the SPY. Just for argument's sake, for the sake of a hypothetical conversation. At the same time, Apple would be trading lower as well. Now, if Apple was in this zone, 136, 137, 138, not sure exactly where it would have to be, but I would be looking for signs that the market was finding some semblance of support, because I'm not going to take a long trade in any stock when the market's getting killed, especially in a downtrending situation like we are now, because everything is going to get thrown out with the bathwater. So you have to wait for the market to find support. So let's just say, hypothetically, the market was finding support around that 240 level. Now, if Apple was in that zone at that time, I'm likely to take a trade if it gave me the setup, the sign, the signal of a trend change. If everything was there, if the setup was there, I'll be looking at Apple in this range for a trade. It's just a trade. I'm not looking to marry the stock, just a trade. I'm not even looking to buy an iPhone. Looking for a couple of bucks. Or more. And by the way, that brings me to another point, which is just to remind traders that especially when we're in environments like this where the market is crazy, whippy all around all day long, you have to take profit when they hand you profit. You don't have to take it all. Take half, take a third, whatever it is, you have to take profit along the way. When you get to a final destination, a final target of where you're trading to, I'm telling you right now, professional traders out there do not have their full position on at target. It's very rare, and if they do, they were gambling a little bit and got a little bit lucky. The why behind that is really obvious. We're in an environment now where the swings intraday can be extremely, extremely large. And as traders, you don't want to turn a winning trade into a loser. If you're in the money and you take some profit and whatever you're in goes back to where the point in which you got in the trade exists, you can make a decision to get out of the trade the second half or whatever you have left without taking a loss, and you still made money with the profit you took. The problem many traders have is they look at the what if. Well, if I held, I would have made this much money. And what that does, and pay attention because I know this for a fact, and so do you, what that does is it affects and impacts in a negative way your next trade. When you're in the money on the next trade, you're going to be reluctant to take a profit. You want it all because you remember what happened last time. You think you made a mistake, but last time you played it correctly. This time, when you hold on to the whole thing, you're likely to take a loss. That's the way it works. You know that, and I know that. Okay, let's get back on the rails or back in our correct lane over here, and we'll look at the XBD. I want to take a look at the financials. We'll start with the XBD. We'll look at the XLF as well. So the XBD was only down 1.5% today. I say only, that's a big down day, $3.50 or so. But it's interesting that it didn't get killed. Again, that kind of goes in the camp of, are we going to see some kind of a higher low develop? Too early, not just yet. Just want to bring it to our attention. Now we look at the XLF, and we were down about 2.25%, so it was more of a down day across the XLF, and the inside the XLF are, among other things, what's called the money center banks. Bank of America, JP Morgan, Wells Fargo. PNC. Those type of organizations are in the XLF as opposed to the broker-dealer, Morgan Stanley, UBS, Goldman Sachs. Although Goldman Sachs is probably in both. Some of those are probably in both anyway. But you can see the importance of this, which is yesterday's low. Let me move the chart over. And yesterday's low was 2340. Today's low was 2342. It's not an accident or a coincidence. Let's go prove the point one more time. There's the low, 2340. Let's go down to a 10-minute chart, and you'll see the 2340, we made a run for it, came up a couple of cents short, and had a rally away from it. I know it's only a few cents. We're just splitting hairs over a few pennies. That's not the point. The point is the concept of what happens. I probably picked the wrong vehicle to prove the point, but the concept of what happens at these breakup candle lows and breakdown candle highs repeats on any chart we look at. It doesn't matter what the vehicle is. That's why I repeatedly tell people that it doesn't matter what you trade. You want to trade the S&P E-mini futures? You want to trade the NASDAQ market? You want to trade the Qs? You want to trade a stock? You want to trade a Forex pair? It doesn't make any difference what you trade. All charts act and react the same way. Doesn't matter what the name is behind the chart. I've shown you that over and over again. I prove that in my course over and over again. The SMH, the semiconductors, got smoked, taken out behind the woodshed, shot seven times, and then they killed it, 6%. It's just an unbelievably tremendous down day in the SMH. The SMH is a leading indicator for the tech sector. Apple, all the ecosystem around Apple, all the companies that supply the parts that go into the phones and all the other products were impacted by Apple's news. You live by the apple, you die by the apple. How do you like them apples? Here's a weekly chart. You can see it already. Closing tomorrow below last week's low is bad and will bring in the 200 period moving average right into vision. So we definitely have, at least from the short run, we have the indications that the market's pointing downward. You don't have to be a genius to figure out that we're likely going to see lower prices before any kind of a rally comes to this market. How about the TLT? This is the bond market. This was the easiest trade on the board. I gave this trade out somewhere around the summer or right after the summer. I said, when we get down to around 111.50, even 112, 112.50, it won't matter. You can just buy it. You'll remember this, 111.50. We came up just short. Let me move the chart. And the low happened to be 111.90. And now we're at 123.54. You take some profit along the way, and then you let the rest ride and see how high it can go. Anybody that's in this from down around 112, even 113, whatever it was, anybody still in at least a piece of this thing, you just wouldn't let it get below the moving averages. In fact, I wouldn't let it get below the 20-period moving average. Any daily close below the 20-period moving average, and I would sell it, and that would be the end of it. Right now, I would ride it as high as I could. I don't still own it. I did. I sold it all, and obviously now I'm sorry that I did. However, in this particular case, do as I say, not as I did. Here's gold. We talked about gold. Gold's probably headed to around 1320. Could go higher, but you're likely to find resistance around 1318 to 1320. Right now, you have the fear trade on with gold. The market's going down. For whatever reason, gold's going up. It's in an uptrend, so 1320 is my near-term target. Now, when I use the term target, don't misunderstand what I'm saying about gold. I'm not long gold, and I'm not saying it has to get to 1320. I'm saying if it gets to 1320, you should find resistance, or gold should find resistance at 1320. We also are right around resistance now. On the weekly chart, you can see we're into the 100 period moving average. Doesn't have to hold. We could bust through it and actually close above it tomorrow. And if that happened, 1320 would be an oh by the way, and there would actually be higher prices also. All of a sudden, crude oil is now disconnected from the market. All of a sudden, crude oil is now starting to push higher. You can see what's going on here. We had this big reversal day, and now we're basically eating time off the clock, working our way higher. If we continue edging higher in crude oil, they'll want to go to 50. There's a gap up here. And then they're going to want to go to 51 and a half. One step at a time, it's just not going to run up to 51, 52 bucks. But the point is, it's not going down. We had a reversal, and we have something to trade against for anybody that wants to trade in crude oil. And with that, I'm going to give it a wrap here. I'm David Frost, My Strategic Forecast. Thanks for tuning in for another episode of Common Sense Market Analysis.